Today I'll be installing this new Gen 4 NVMe SSD drive into my existing desktop computer. And after I get it up and running, I will convert it to being my primary drive that has the operating system on it. My computer currently has a Gen 3 NVMe drive. That one will stay on board and become one that I use for extra storage. Prior to buying the new drive, I made sure that my ASUS motherboard had two NVMe slots, M.2, and that it supports the Gen 4 standard. Even if it only supported the Gen 3 standard, the new drive will still work because it's backward compatible, but I would not get the extra speed benefit that comes with Gen 4. First, I'm going to physically install the new drive, which is a 2TB Samsung 980 Pro. There tends to be a lot of static in this room that I'm working in, so I'm going to do everything I can to avoid damaging a component from static discharge. I'll be wearing an anti-static wristband. I'll attach the cord to a screw that's on the back of the power supply. The computer is powered down, and the button on the power supply is in the off position. I taped the button down so I don't accidentally turn it on. I'm leaving the power cord plugged into the outlet just to be 100% sure that the computer is grounded. I'll first move the graphics card out of the way. As mentioned, this motherboard has two M.2 slots. My existing drive is plugged into a slot under this heatsink here. The open slot is over here, which is a little bit underneath the processor fan. It doesn't have a metal heatsink like the other one, and for now I don't plan on adding one. The stickers that come on these drives are designed to be a heatsink. That combined with the air from the fans should be enough to keep this one cool. If it does get too hot, the computer will know and it'll slow the unit down to cool it. If I find it's doing that often, I'll add a heatsink. In line with that slot are several screw holes. When the drive is installed, one end will be in the slot, and the other end will be screwed down using one of those holes. The numerous holes allow for different sized drives. The hole I'll be using is the one marked 2280. If you aren't sure what size your drive is, you should be able to find it wherever the specs of the drive are listed. If not, you can just lay the drive across the area and it should be obvious which hole lines up with it. At this point in the process, I noticed a problem. I actually don't have a screw. I also need something called a standoff, and I need a washer, none of which were in my motherboard box. So I had to get in the car and head out to Micro Center, and I bought this little bag, which has the screws, the standoffs, and the washers. By the way, if you buy a package like this, make sure you're getting the ones that correspond to your motherboard. These are specifically designed for ASUS motherboards. Mine was $11, but you can get these for a lot cheaper on Amazon. I'll be sure to leave some affiliate links in the description. What I need to do first is screw the standoff into the hole. It's a tight space, so it's hard to do without blocking the camera. Then I need to put a washer on top of the standoff. The washer is very tiny, so it took several attempts to get it just right. If I sneeze, the washer would be lost forever within the motherboard. It's also practically invisible when it is in place, but trust me, it's on there. Now I will insert the drive. There's a notch on the end that lines up with the notch in the slot. I'm going to slide it into the slot at an angle. And once it's firmly in there, I'm gonna press down on the rest of the drive and screw it in. Since it's a tight space, I can only use one hand and it wants to fling upward. So I ended up having to put something on top of it to weigh it down as I put the screw in. In case it's not clear at this point, the washer needs to go in between the standoff and the drive. And the screw just goes through the hole that's on the drive. There's one screw hole that's still available, and I'm gonna use it to store a spare standoff, washer, and screw, just in case I need one of those again one day. If you feel I'm doing a good job in describing this process, you may wanna think about hitting that like button. It helps out a lot, thank you. With the physical install complete, I now have to do some things to get it up and running. I'll power on the computer as normal. There's no need to go into the BIOS at this point. When I open up a folder, the new drive isn't showing up, which is normal for a new unused drive that has just been installed. I first need to initialize it. I'm gonna right click on the Windows symbol and choose Disk Management. the app will open up two windows. The back one shows information about the drives, and the pop-up asks me if I want to initialize the new drive. If you did this and you didn't get that pop-up, you'll want to trigger it. Go to the section here that shows a graphical breakdown of the drives, and you should see one that has an empty rectangle that says unallocated. It also has a red dot to the left. Right-click on the gray area and select Initialize Disk. You'll then get the pop-up that I just had. I have to choose between two different partition styles, MBR or GPT. I'm going to choose GPT. In general terms, MBR is an outdated standard that's on its way out. Everyone recommends GPT for modern builds. I'll click OK. The red dot that was beside the new drive has disappeared, but it still shows a rectangle of unallocated space. I'm going to right-click on that rectangle and select New Simple Volume. A wizard will appear. I'll click Next. It wants to know what size to make the volume. I'm going to make the whole thing one gigantic volume, so I'm just going to use the whole amount, which is what this screen defaults to. If you aren't a simpleton like me, you may wish to make multiple volumes. I'll speak more about that in a minute. For now, I'm going to click Next. Here I need to assign a letter. I'll choose Z and click Next. Now it's asking if I want to format it, and I do. Just remember that formatting erases everything on the drive. That's not a problem for me since mine has nothing on it. I'm going to leave it as NTFS. I can give the drive a name here if I want. I'm going to call it Gen 4 SSD. And I'm going to leave these checkboxes as they are and click Next, then Finish. I can now begin using the drive as normal. It appears in the folder with the label and drive letter I gave it. Now let me back up a moment to that one screen where I was making a simple volume. If I choose less than the full amount of space, it'll only make that portion usable. I can then click the unused portion and make a volume out of that. If I did two volumes, the end result would look like this. There's a lot of reasons why people might do this. They may want to employ a dual booting setup. They may want to use one of the volumes as a backup for another. They may do it for security reasons because one gigantic volume is easier to get into than multiple ones. Or maybe they just want to be more organized by having certain drives dedicated to certain things. For now though, I'm just going to keep it as one big volume. Now that the drive is up and running, I'm going to go through the process of making it my primary drive that runs Windows. There's other ways to phrase that, but I'll just stick to saying I'm going to make it my primary drive. The reason I want the new drive to become the primary drive is that the computer should run faster since I'm upgrading to a Gen 4 SSD. I'll run a speed test at the end of the video to confirm this. Currently, the primary drive is a Gen 3. That drive I will eventually format to become just extra storage. When people want to create a new primary drive, there's two very different routes to take. One is to use a cloning program, which takes everything on the old drive and puts it onto the new one. The other way is to do a clean install of Windows onto the new drive, and then manually move other things from the old drive to the new one. I'm going to choose the cloning method, and that's what I'll be showing for the rest of this video. I advise that you watch me do the cloning process, and then afterwards watch some videos on how to do a clean install of Windows, and then determine which method you would prefer. In order to clone, I need to find a program that does it for me. You might ask, why not just copy and paste everything from one drive to another? Everything I have read about that says that it will not work. Windows can't function properly unless the new drive is a sector by sector duplicate of the other, which can only be done through cloning. If Windows wasn't involved with this operation, a simple copy and paste should work. Many programs that clone cost money, which sucks if you're only going to use the program this one time. But one free one that's out there is called Clonezilla. It's an open source program. I dug deep into it, but I ended up not using it. But here's a short summary of how it works. You put the program on a thumb drive, then you boot the computer and go into the BIOS, and then run the program off the thumb drive. There's a lot of screens where you have to make choices on what you want to do. On most of them, you can just choose choose option one. The reason I chose not to use Clonezilla is because it would not work for my scenario. I have two 2TB drives, but in actuality, the old drive is a tiny bit bigger than the new one. Clonezilla does not easily allow you to clone a bigger drive to a smaller one. I tried some workarounds, including shrinking the size of the old drive, but nothing worked. I could have pressed further, but I didn't want to risk accidentally wiping the wrong drive. Like I mentioned, there's a lot of screens, and it's easy to get confused at some point in the process. Most other cloning programs out there are much simpler, but I do appreciate that people have put work into creating Clonezilla. One that many people use is Macrium Reflect. I might be saying that incorrectly. According to their site, it has a 30-day free trial, and that includes the ability to clone. I did not experiment with that one. But before you choose any of those that I just mentioned, I suggest you see if the company that made your drive has a free cloning tool of its own. I'm fortunate because my new drive is a Samsung and they have a free tool called SSD Magician. But it only works if the drive you're going to clone your data to is a Samsung one. It's okay if the drive you're cloning from isn't a Samsung. I should clarify that not all Samsung drives work with this software. Here are the ones that do. So after downloading and opening the program, it shows a lot of stuff which may look intimidating, but I'm only going to use one small part of it. Notice there's two tabs at the top, one for each drive, and I can click between the two. To start the process, I have to select the tab with the old drive, the one with the operating system on it, then select the data migration option. It lists the source drive at the top, which is my old drive, and it instructs me to select a Samsung drive for the target. In a nutshell, this is going to copy everything from the first drive and dump it into the second one. And unlike Clonezilla, it doesn't care if the one I'm copying to is slightly smaller than the other one. I click start, and then it informs me that the computer is going to shut off afterward, and it asks me to confirm whether or not this is something I want to do. I'll click OK. It then goes through the process of copying. It took about 25 minutes to complete, which is surprisingly fast given that it was about 1.3 terabytes of data. When I turned the computer back on, I was quite surprised to see three different drive letters, C, D, and E. The E one would not let me go into it without permission. I was not expecting it to do that, but I did see that it had copied the entire contents of the old drive and added it to the new one. Now I needed to see if the new drive could stand on its own. So I shut everything down and went inside the computer and removed the old drive. This will force the computer to boot up from the operating system that is on the new drive, which is ultimately what I want to do. So I turned the computer back on. I did not need to go into the BIOS. I just let it boot up and everything looked great. Even better, there was no unexpected drive letter this time. It renamed the old drive the C drive, and that's the only drive letter that's showing. I played around a lot just to make sure everything was running correctly, and then I shut it down again and inserted the old drive back into the computer and turned it back on. This time I stepped into the BIOS screen during the boot up, and I looked at the boot order. It now puts the new drive at the top of the order, which is what I want, because I want it to get Windows from that drive, and not the Windows that's on the old drive. It reordered those on its own because of the way I took one of the drives out and did a boot up without it. So I let it fully power back up, and now I have two drive letters showing. The new one remains C, and the old drive has been changed to D. Everything is functioning as expected. Eventually, I'm going to erase everything on the old drive by formatting it and just use it as extra storage, but I'm not going to do that right here in front of you because I want to give it a couple of weeks before I do that, just to be 100% sure. Now, I mentioned a speed test, and I went ahead and did that. Since the primary drive is a Gen 4, things should go faster, and I used a free program called Crystal Disk to confirm, and as expected, the Gen 4 runs a lot faster. However, when I went about doing the normal things I do on this computer, I was not noticing a speed increase. It seems to be the same as it was. For instance, I rendered a small piece of video on the old drive and the new drive, and the speed was the same on both. So I need to do more research on what things are actually faster when you upgrade a drive like this. But the bottom line is that the process worked, and I'm thankful that it did. I hope you found this video useful. Take care, everybody.